everyone, welcome to Bannack. My name is Siobhan. I am the AmeriCorps member here for 2020. So usually in March and April, we start to see a lot more visitors and get to start doing tours. But since the park has been temporarily closed due to COVID-19, we thought it would be really fun to do a virtual tour. So gold was discovered here in Grasshopper Creek in 1862 by a man named John White, and he named it Grasshopper Creek. Previously, it had been named Willard's Creek when Lewis and Clark traveled through this area, but John White gave it a new name, and that's what stuck. Now, when John White got here, of course, he was not the first person in this area. This was the traditional hunting land for a couple different Native American tribes, mostly the Northern and Lemhi Shoshone, the Salish, and the Bannock Indians. And of course, Bannock sounds very much like Bannock, and that is where the town got its name. But when they went to submit the name officially, it ended up getting misspelled to Bannock, and that's what the town was named. So when the miners started to come up here after they found out there was gold, they realized that the conditions in this area could be very, very harsh. And the Native Americans that lived here over multiple generations had learned and adapted how to live here, but the miners realized that the winters could get as cold as negative 62 degrees and the summers could get to over 100 degrees. There are bears and rattlesnakes in this area, and of course the main thing that grows here is sagebrush, which is not edible for humans, so it could be very difficult to live here. But despite it all, there was gold, so they came up here anyways. And by the end of 1862, there were close to 400 people living in this area. And by the end of that following spring of 1863, there were over 3,000 people living here. The town that we have today is mostly just one street, but of course, when there were close to 3,000 people living here, they were filling up a lot more of the surrounding area. So over behind these trees here is an area called the Yankee Flats. And 1862 and 63 were right in the middle of the Civil War. And while there were no battles or any fighting that occurred in this area, the people that were coming here definitely still had the political opinions of the day. So a group of Minnesotans or Northerners moved in over there, so they all referred to that as the Yankee Flats. So when people were moving out to Bannack, they weren't actually moving to Montana yet. They were still moving into Dakota Territory. And in 1863, it ended up becoming Idaho Territory. So that year, Sidney Edgerton, who had been appointed the Chief Justice of Idaho, moved his family out from Ohio to Bannack and settled down here. When he got here, he saw all of the people that were moving here and all of the gold that was being produced, and really felt that this area needed to be its own separate territory. So he traveled to Washington, D.C. and started petitioning to have this new territory created. And in May of 1864, Montana Territory was created. The main justifications for creating this new territory were all the gold that were being produced, which of course could help fund the Civil War, and all of the crime and violence that were associated with the gold rush. So as he was traveling back, he was appointed the first governor of Montana, and since he was living here in Bannack, Bannack was then designated as the first territorial capital of Montana. So he originally was living over here. He was living in just a standard one-room log cabin, which today we refer to as the governor's mansion, which of course is a bit of a misnomer. It eventually burned down, and it was said that the logs that were salvaged out of the fire were actually used to build this shack back here. So Sidney Edgerton's wife, Mary, was a prolific letter writer. She would constantly write to her family back in Ohio and back east and talk a lot about their time here in Montana. She often described how harsh the conditions could be, and in one of her letters back home, she talked about how the winter was so cold in 1863 that at night the frost would come in through the windows and it would cover their blankets and cover their heads, and she would have to go and check that all of the kids were still breathing at night. So we do know a fair amount about their time here in Bannack, thanks to her. So living in such harsh conditions would mean that having a doctor would be really important, and this was the house of Dr. Ryburn. So Dr. Ryburn practiced here in Bannack from 1897 until 1915. The way that the house is designed is not exactly how he had it, but this is a representation of what it could have looked like in the day. So before Dr. Ryburn was here, more towards the beginning of Bannack, there were a few other doctors such as Dr. Glick and Dr. Levitt. At one point in the early 1890s, there was also a female doctor named Mary Moore practicing here in Bannack as well. One of the main issues that doctors here had to deal with were epidemics that would come through town. There were a few different ones, influenza, scarlet fever, diphtheria, whooping cough, and many others all came through town. So this is the schoolhouse of Bannack. It was built in 1874 by the Masons. They built this two-story building with a school on the first floor and the second floor as their Masonic temple. Today it is a historic lodge that is still used once a year. So before this school was built, kids could still access education. Often that was through a subscription school, which was like a small private school ran out of someone's home. The niece of Governor Edgerton, Lucia Darling, who lived with them, actually ran a subscription school out of their house. In 1866, a system of public education was created here in Montana, but it wasn't until 1874 that we actually got a building dedicated specifically to public education. So we're going to go inside and look around. So here in the school, up on the blackboard, we have some questions that we always like to ask. The first question asks what year Montana Territory was created, and the second question asks what year Montana became a state. So if you've been paying attention, you should probably be able to answer these. Also up here on the board, we have the rules for teachers. So women didn't have a lot of opportunity at the time. But one job that women could have that was considered a respectable job was being a teacher. But as you can see, according to rule number one, you can't get married during your term of service. It was assumed that if you got married, you would need to quit your job and move in with your husband. Women at the time, other than being a teacher, could hold some other jobs, usually domestic jobs, such as being a laundress or a seamstress or a cook, but of course the main position for women at the time was of course being a wife and a homemaker and a mother. And a little bit later we'll talk more about some of the less respectable positions for women. Over here is the assay office. This was one of the most important buildings in Bannack.
So this is where miners could bring their gold to have it tested. And it was common in Bannack to have gold usually between 80 to about 90% pure.
So once it had been tested, they could do two things with it. They could either sell it to the U.S. government, which was the only place you could legally sell your gold to, or they could hang on to it and use it as currency. During this time, the greenback had been introduced, but it wasn't very common out here and it wasn't very trusted, so people would usually keep their gold and use it as currency. So it was very common in most of the stores to have a scale at the counter so that they could weigh their gold. So next to the assay office, we have the city drugstore.
So Bannack was lived in for over 100 years, so all of the buildings and homes that we see served multiple purposes.
So today we call this the city drugstore, but at one point it was a butcher, it was another assay office. It also served as a school when the main school was full or in disrepair. So one of our most notable buildings, which also served multiple purposes over time, is the Mead Hotel. It was originally built in 1876 as the county courthouse. So back at the beginning of the tour, I mentioned that Bannack was the first territorial capital of Montana. Well, that didn't end up lasting very long. After about a year, there was a much larger gold find up near Virginia City, and eventually the capital was moved up there. But we were still the county seat for Beaverhead County until in 1880, Dillon, which is not too far from us, got the railroad, and their population quickly boomed. They became a center for freighting and quickly surpassed the population of Bannack. And once they did, they felt that they should be the county seat for Beaverhead County. So by 1881, after a bit of a battle, the county seat ended up getting moved. So this was originally built as the county courthouse, but was only used so for a few years. Once the county seat was moved, the building sat empty for about a decade until in 1891 it was purchased by the Mead family and turned into the Mead Hotel. When they purchased it, they did a lot of renovations and they put on an addition on the back with a kitchen and a dining room so it could be a fully functioning hotel. So we are going to go inside and look at a few features. So the courthouse was built to be very impressive. It isn't necessarily the most practical building for this area, but it is very large and impressive, with the very large grand staircase, the ceilings are 18 feet high, and they have these large safes. So in 1877, there was the flight of the Nez Perce, which occurred not too far from here, or it's often known as the Battle of the Big Hole, which was a fight between the U.S. military and the Nez Perce tribe. And after that occurred, the citizens of Bannack were very concerned about an attack here on town. And at that point, a lot of ranching had started in this area. So there were a lot of ranchers and a lot of small communities all spread out. So people felt that it would be safest to all come into Bannack in case of a counterattack. There is a story that they had originally planned that if there was an attack, they were going to place women and children inside of the safe to protect them.
So when you first enter the hotel, you can definitely see how much time was put into making this a very impressive building. And here we can see the kitchen addition to when the building was converted into a hotel.
So the town of Bannack has quite a few ghost stories. One of our most popular ones is the story of Dorothy Dunn. When she was 16 years old, she drowned in Grasshopper Creek, and she worked here at the hotel, so there are a lot of people that have said that they have seen her here. She is often seen in a blue gown, so she is often referred to as the girl in blue. So this is the inside of Skinner's Saloon. It's the last remaining saloon here in Bannack. And saloons at the time were very important. They would often be the first business to open up in a mining town. And they provided a lot of services that were difficult to get otherwise. Of course, food and drink were very big at a saloon. Services were also something that you could come to a saloon for. So a town like Bannack may not have a permanent dentist or barber. But people with professions like those would often travel around to different mining towns and set up in a public place like a saloon. And when the barber was here, you could sit and get your hair cut. Saloons also provided a lot of entertainment, which was definitely something that could be hard to come by in a remote mining town. So there could be music. Pianos weren't actually that common. Usually smaller instruments like fiddles or guitars were more common. But that provided dancing. You could come and socialize and play card games or gamble. There, of course, then were the less respectable positions for women that could be found at a saloon, such as prostitution, which was very common, and hurdy-gurdies. Those were women that would spend time in a saloon and you could pay them basically to spend time with you. They might dance with you or talk to you and you could buy them a drink. So it was kind of a way for men to guarantee a little female company. The hurdy-gurdies got their name from instruments that you could wind up and would play automatically. Now, hurdy-gurdies and prostitutes weren't necessarily the same things. They could overlap, but that didn't necessarily mean that they always did. There were other forms of entertainment in Bannack. There was a baseball league here at one time. Ice skating in the winter was popular for all ages. Dances were often held. The school children put on plays sometimes. But of course, the main activity would be to come to the saloon and drink, which would often result in a lot of violence. So, of course, all of the drinking often led to a lot of senseless violence and crime. There was a story about the hurdy-gurdy Nellie Paget. She one night was dancing with a man, and another man came in and, in a bit of a jealous rage, shot her because if he couldn't have her, nobody could. There are also stories of different shootouts that occurred here. They weren't necessarily the shootouts that happened in the movies. There was one between two men named George Ives and George Carhart, and George Ives got shot in the groin. He was eventually hanged in Nevada City. Later, though, George Carhart was sleeping in the corner of a saloon, and two men who were just across the table from each other tried to shoot each other and ended up shooting George Carhart. So back towards the beginning of the tour, I talked about Sidney Edgerton and his effort in creating the Montana Territory. And the two main reasons that we stated for creating the territory was, of course, the gold production and all of the crime that was occurring. It was very common for crime to follow the gold rush, but there was a lot of crime occurring in Bannack, mostly with a gang called the Road Agents. They were a group of highway robbers that would stop people often on their way out of town from Bannack and take all of their gold from them. So in response to all of this crime that was occurring, a group of men in Montana Territory created their own group that they called the Vigilantes, and they would travel around and try and create some order of, or create some kind of justice and order. Eventually, they came to Bannack and created their own chapter here of the Bannack Vigilantes, and their main goal was to put a stop to the road agent gang. So while all of this was going on, there was a man named Henry Plummer who had traveled from Nevada City out to Bannack. When he was living in Nevada City, he had gotten into a fight with a man and ended up killing him and was sent to 10 years at San Quentin. He only ended up serving less than a year, but after that he decided it was time to get out of Dodge and ended up coming up north. When he got to town, he tried his hand at mining, didn't really like it, and decided that he was going to put his hat in the ring for becoming the sheriff of Bannack. Before this happened, he had ended up getting into another squabble with a man named Jack Cleveland and ended up killing Jack Cleveland very publicly, but he was acquitted. And despite all of that, he ended up getting elected the sheriff of Bannack in 1863. So when the Vigilantes were in Bannack and they were trying to find out who all these road agents were, they captured a man who had allegedly been a part of this gang named Red Yeager. And they made Red confess to being part of the gang and write a list convicting all of the people who were in the gang. And Red Yeager wrote down three very important names. Two of those names were Ned Ray and Buck Stinson, who were the sheriff's deputies. And then he said that the ringleader behind this whole gang was Sheriff Henry Plummer. So that was all they needed. So the Vigilantes set out and rounded up these three men. And on January 10th of 1864, they hanged them. So we are going to go around the corner and see the gallows where they were hanged.
So these are not the original gallows, but this is the original location. Originally, it was just two trees with a board across the top, and it had been ordered by Sheriff Plummer to be built. Now, Bannack did have a jail. It was the first jail in Montana, but instead of usually sending someone to jail that had committed a crime, it was more common for them to be killed, either by hanging or shooting, or to banish them from town. The issue with sending someone to jail meant that someone else had to stay and watch the jail, which meant that person couldn't be watching their mining claim and might lose money, which is why it was more common to just hang someone as opposed to actually putting them in jail.
So Bannack was lived in for over 100 years and mined for a very long time. So it went through different phases of mining. The first people to come here and mine in Bannack were placer mining, or panning for gold in the creek mostly. They were using the very basic forms of mining, sluice boxes, panning. Gold is very dense. It always wants to find the lowest point in the area. And when gold would get loose in the hills, it would make its way down to the creek bed. So once the gold was discovered in the creek and they had panned most of the gold out of it, they moved on to hydraulic mining. So they would build ditches along the hillsides and pump water through them, and then shoot water through these hydraulic monitors here, and that would disrupt the soil, and that would go down and be collected in sluice boxes and sorted through.
You can actually still see a lot of the ditches in the hillsides around town. They eventually moved on to dredge mining, which is when they would have large dredge boats sitting on top of the creek, and those dredges had large buckets underneath that would sift through all of the rock on the bottom of the creek and sort through it for gold.
Four of the five dredges were steam-powered, and the fifth dredge was actually electric. Those four steam-powered dredges, though, could go through eight cords in a single day, so they used up a lot of timber. The electric gold dredge, though, was actually the first electric gold dredge in the U.S. While most of all of these other forms of mining were occurring, they were also hard rock mining, which is when they would extract chunks of the sides of the hills and, usually in a mill, crush it and extract the bits of gold. We had multiple mills in this area, but we still have one today, which is the Apex Mill, and in the summer we do guided tours of that. So the miners that were initially coming here to Bannack weren't planning on staying very long. With the gold rush, it was more common that people would travel to a gold strike, stay there for a little while, and then move on to the next big gold strike. But as winter started to approach, they realized that they were going to need better housing to survive the winter. They were mostly staying in tents and wickiups or living out of their wagons, so they started constructing these small cabins.
And since they were so small, it was very common for them to live together, hence the name Bachelor's Row.
So what we can really see here in Bannack is the evolution of the town. Again, it was lived in for over 100 years. So behind me here is Chrisman's store. This was an operation roughly in the 1860s, and it was said that that's where Sheriff Plummer actually had his office. It was a very popular place for men to come together and socialize.
It was often considered the library and the university of Bannack. Now, next to Chrisman's store is Ovitz's store, which operated in the 1960s. It was owned and operated by Mabel Ovitz until her death, and today it houses our archival collection.
So the house behind me here is the Rowe Graves House. It was built in the 1860s by Mr. Rowe. He initially came to Bannack to make his fortune mining and realized that it was really hard to actually get rich mining, but he realized that he could start different businesses and actually make a lot more money. So he ended up opening up a butcher shop and ended up getting into banking. Eventually, he moved out and a man named F.L. Graves moved in with his family into this house. He was the person that actually brought the first electric gold dredge here to Bannack. He was also very wealthy. He was a very diversified businessman. This house actually has 7 doors that lead from the interior to the exterior. So this is what we really could consider the mansion of Bannack. So this is the Church of Bannack. It was built in 1877.
Before the church was built, accessing religion could be very difficult out here, but what they did have were circuit riders, or traveling ministers and preachers, that would go around to different mining towns and set up in usually a public place such as a saloon and preach.
A circuit rider that came through Bannack quite a bit was named Brother William Wesley Van Orsdale, which is a mouthful of a name, so he would usually go by Brother Van. And when he would travel here, he would often set up in the saloon and he would get to preach for an hour. They wouldn't sell any alcohol and it would be open to the public. So they started constructing this church in 1877. And as we mentioned earlier in the hotel, that was when the Battle of the Big Hole, or the Flight of the Nez Perce, occurred. So, when brother Van was here that summer, he noticed all of these people that had come into Bannack really equated to a lot of labor. So he gathered everyone together, and as the story goes, he used all of the labor that was here in town to finish the construction of the church. Thank you so much for joining us on our tour. We really hope you guys enjoyed it. Starting next Monday, we'll be going live on Facebook and Instagram, doing a deep dive into a different topic or person. So stay tuned for those. Thanks.